Welcome. Welcome very, very much to Conversation. A pleasure to welcome to the program a friend of mine, a friend of the world, that being Anthony or Tony Gronowicz.
Right.
And he's a professor of history and politics at the City University of New York, and he's put my attention to a piece that has been out just recently into the society about tax havens that we want to do a program about. We're going to have a clip about it into the program. But he's also a candidate for the 14th congressional district in the Green Party candidacy for the House of Representatives. And Tony, welcome so much. It's good
Thank
to have you
again,
back
Hal.
On the set.
Thank you.
I've been trying to enlist him to become a regular producer to bring some intellectual class to our roster to join the faculty. But that's off camera, but that's an aside remark. Tony, it's so good to see you again.
Same here, Howard.
Talk a little bit. Let's talk a little bit. You're running for Congress now.
That's right.
And we're going to do another program today with one of your running mates, Coley Clark, who's
right.
running
she's
for Senate.
She's heading our ticket in New York State.
Yeah.
But for Senate.
Talk
and we have
about
a presidential
about
candidate, Jill Stein, who was just arrested with her running mate in Philadelphia
what
protesting
for?
The banks.
For protesting
having a sit
the
in the banks and Fannie Mae.
Wonderful. Good
yeah.
for her. That's the kind of thing I'd like to hear more of, which we're going to do with this program.
Anyway, the 14th yeah. CD is mm-hmm. Eastern Bronx and Western Queens.
Uh-huh.
And I'm running against Joe Crowley, who voted for the Iraq War.
Oh, boy, oh, boy.
One of the 83 Democrats in the Congress to do so.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
it's a sad chapter
yeah.
in U.S. history and...
You've been on that old peace train for a long time, haven't you, Tony?
Yeah, since I went on the Easter Peace Walk when I was a freshman at Columbia in April of 1964.
Oh, boy, that's going back some. Yeah, that's right.
Exactly.
Back to the good old days, yeah.
That was my first march.
Uh-huh.
And I've been marching ever since.
64, right?
64.
Good for you. We need that kind of thing. That was early. That was all the civil rights stuff was coming up and
right,
everything
exactly.
like that. And we were barreling into the age of Aquarius or... They're coming up to the Woodstock thing. The Vietnam War was so horrendous.
We were anticipating Lyndon Johnson's escalation.
Uh-huh.
Remember Lyndon Johnson
yeah,
told
sure.
the nation, have no fear of escalation.
yeah, right, right.
Well, this was in the spring. And, uh-huh. of course, he really did escalate the war in August of 64.
Uh-huh. Yeah, right. It was something, yeah. And it was so horrible. And then the nation just got torn apart. Then you had the assassination come 68, you had Martin King.
Well,
Bobby
Malcolm
Good.
Started it off in yeah. 65, and then 68, Martin and Bobby in
yeah.
quick succession.
That was I still hold with the fact that there was something as Bobby Dylan. He had his antenna right on the tone of the tune and tone of the zeitgeist with his poetry at that particular.
Oh, yeah.
He was right on the money,
definitely.
Saying something's
but
blowing in the wind.
But he had a great muse, yeah. Woody Guthrie.
Yeah, right. Wasn't he great?
Woody Guthrie was the icon.
Yeah, right. That's right. And then
to which Bobby Dylan looked up to.
Absolutely. Yeah, he did. Yeah. Bob Zinnemann and everything like that. But that was a major time. There was a major, I think there were major things going on in terms of the zeitgeist that were major at that time. Woodstock, landing on the moon, the beginning of cable television is 1970. There was a time of qualitative change that's still growing. But you've been doing that for a long time. I congratulate you enormously on staying the course.
The counterculture had deep roots and
uh-huh.
is still being resuscitated today in
right.
terms of, you know, the musicals and the music.
Yeah. And you were studying history, I guess, right?
I was studying history at Columbia.
Uh-huh.
And I remember I was head of the history club, and I mm-hmm. called William Appleman Williams because I just read his book, Contours of American History, which mm-hmm. at the time I regarded as my new Bible.
Really? Okay.
And I called him up. He couldn't make it, but he was the one. That book came out in 1960.
Okay. He couldn't make it. What do you mean? To...
Well, he was at Wisconsin.
Oh, I see.
And then he went to Oregon.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. But what do you mean he couldn't make it?
Well, he couldn't fly in.
You wanted him to come in for an event or something?
To give a presentation.
Yeah, right,
But he couldn't fit it into a schedule.
Boy, it goes back more and more. You're back to 60 now.
You've
been making trouble, right?
Right, exactly.
What about the family? Was it political and everything, the family setting when you were growing up and all that?
Yeah, it was.
Or did you get to be so dedicated at such a relatively young age?
Well, because my parents on both sides were very political.
Were they, uh-huh.
Right. Not at all religious, but very political.
Right.
And very aware of what was going on in the world.
Uh-huh.
So I was encouraged to, but of course, that you were riding the crest of a wave then.
Yes.
In the 60s.
Right.
And of course, what's coming now is a tsunami. The current generation is riding the tsunami, the Occupy generation.
I know. Yeah, right. I want to agree with you. I hope that that is the case.
Well, I think it's the case because the 60s was all about the draft. When the draft ended, at least for the white youth, the issues ended. And of course, the war ended a year later, 2 years later in 75.
Yeah.
But the debt isn't going away. The issue is debt. In fact, the slogan for Occupy this September 17th, the one-year anniversary of the first Occupy, is going to be debt and money out of politics and the environment. Debt, money out of politics, and the environment.
You were at the convention they had recently?
Which one?
The Green Party.
Oh, yes. I was in Baltimore a couple of weeks ago, and we had the national convention. I went there as a delegate for Jill Stein, one of the 13 elected delegates to the convention from New York State, and I voted for Jill, who I had met a year ago today, August 2nd.
No kidding. It is a memorable day. Huh?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. I just realized that. A year ago today at the Green Fest, which was in Alfred, New York at the university, I heard her speak. I went up to her and I said, "You're our candidate."
Okay. So you encouraged her. Was she thinking of it then?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
She's very, very...
We had Cynthia McKinney, didn't we?
That was 4 years before.
Well, it was 4 years before. Okay. Right. Another good feisty fighter. That's
exactly
good. And she got arrested for protesting our current candidate?
This past Saturday, she got arrested. Was it Saturday? No, it was yesterday. What am I saying?
Yeah, okay.
Yesterday in a Philadelphia bank, protesting the way the banks have been behaving.
Did they put her through the system and everything?
You know, I don't know. I haven't got the latest news. But she and her vice presidential candidate, who's from Philadelphia, Sherry Honkala, who is spokesperson for the homeless, was also arrested.
So well, I would say, in a sign, if she was treated that way by the authorities, that, to my way of thinking, is a good sign of a feisty kind of attitude toward confrontation, truth to power, and all of that.
Exactly.
Which the Green Party is about, I think.
Truth to power.
Yeah, and the Green Party is about that.
Absolutely.
It's growing.
It's growing.
They're going to perform well this year. Are we ever going to have an effective, do you think, you're a professor of politics, and you understand it from way back, are we going to be able to have an effective third party critique of the current system?
Well, we have an effective third party.
I mean, effective one.
Well, we have an effective one, but the point is we can't get it in publicity.
Mm-hmm.
The last time we had an effective third party critique, it's because Ross Perot had $100 million of his own money.
That's right,
and he hated Bush, and he wanted to really nail him.
He got damn near 20% of the vote.
That's correct.
Yes.
And he was ahead in California primary before his family was threatened, he said, by the Bush people.
Uh-huh.
And he dropped out. And of course, the corporate media presented him as a flake.
Yeah.
But he still got close to 20% of the vote.
There was
the most since Teddy Roosevelt ran as a third-party candidate in 1912. The Bull Moose.
Right. So a third party can happen. How much, what kind of figures have the Green Party been able when did it get started, even, the Green Party?
Well, in this country, it got started in 84.
84.
And our governor candidate, Howie Hawkins, who got us back on
I
the
love
ballot.
Howie Hawkins.
Howie's
He's
terrific.
Good guy, yeah.
I call him Howie Zowie.
Right.
That's what I call him anyway.
Yeah.
But he got us the nomination, got us the ballot again after we had lost it. He was at the beginning of the Green Party in New York State.
Always called Green Party from the beginning?
Yes.
Okay, because it's right in keeping with the ecological concern,
which
is basic, right?
Well, actually, it arose in large part out of the Clamshell Alliance, which Howie was very active in the 70s. And, of course, Ralph Nader was in there at the beginning as well on the environment in 71. He wrote a preface to a book on the environment.
So in the Occupy movement, it seems to me there was a fellow they just called back. He was on Russian television. They have a lot of stuff on Russian television. And he was from a French professor. And there was a case being brought against somebody, I can't quite get it, but I think it was about Mr. Bloomberg, for the way in which they attacked the Occupy people in Zuccotti Park when they did. It was rather Nazi-like or Gestapo-like when they beat it down. And that was a singular thing. And it seems at that time, when that was in its thing, they were popping up all over the country. There were things going on. It seems to have quieted down now, as though it's been beaten out of existence.
The
Occupy sentiment has been beaten down, and people have gone back to just assuming their normal roles and just accept the normal pattern and all that. It would seem at a certain level. Apparently, I'm happy to say you're shaking your head in the negative.
I just went to a meeting at the staff analysts on 23rd Street a couple of nights ago, and there were over 100 people there.
Okay,
thoroughly diversified, planning for the one-year anniversary.
But it's not...
And a week of activity. And I'm also at the free university meetings, which meet at the Graduate Center of City University or New School. And now... There's going to be a week of courses taught again in Madison Square Park, and a lot of protest that particular week, essentially from the 16th through the 23rd, I believe.
Okay, good. And there's going to be that sentiment.
For September.
And the candidates in the Green Party, Coley Clark, who's going to do a program with his running Senate. So where that sort of sentiment might find...
We fully embrace the Occupy movement.
Right, okay.
There's nobody in the Green Party that I'm aware of that does not... support fully the Occupy movement and the notion of the 1% taking everything and the 99% getting hurt.
Is there anybody within the two parties, the Democrat Republican, that is supportive of that in the same way that people within the Green Party are? And one thing I'd like to connote is that here at Manhattan Network on May Day, when they're trying to breathe some life into the Occupy thing, I like to call it not Occupy Wall Street, Occupy the world, because the whole world is interconnected, and you've got all kinds of things going on in India and other places, that there has to be a qualitative change. They had just little snippets on the networks in terms of time. Here we have 15 hours of programming with it coming in from around the world, trying to breathe life into it. So the Green Party and the MNN, or at least a good part of the people who produce programs here, are a good fit, too.
Absolutely.
Because they fit together on
because
the fact.
Because we speak for the community.
We speak for qualitative change. There's a difference in chemistry between qualitative and quantitative. Quantitative change is one thing. Qualitative change is another. And it's systems across the board.
Right.
And so somewhere that's got to resonate. And just like the, seems to me, I'm just talking off the top of my head as a citizen, but just as the people who are representing the establishment probably think, well, we've beat that out. Now, we've beat them down. We've beat people down all through history. They go back to their thing. They'll go back, and they won't be camping out and having all this stuff. But it will rise.
No, because it's going to rise because of debt. Debt is permanent for the average
person.
And
economic things, which gets us around to the thing we want to talk about today.
Absolutely.
Which is particularly relevant. And it was you who called my attention to it, and I thank you for doing so. You handed out at a picnic where we were on this weekend, and it's a staggering. So why don't you allow you to introduce that article that you've made to my attention to? I've read it and I've gone into it. It's huge and multifaceted. But why don't you the issue that you called to my attention and the reason I got in touch with you about doing this program today?
Well, James Henry was carried in The Guardian, to which I subscribe.
Yeah.
The London-based Guardian, pointed out that worldwide offshore, and it also, when they say offshore, it also means out of sight, inshore, on the shore, $21 trillion minimum being squirreled away with no oversight in secret by the 1%.
$21 trillion. That's
more
staggering.
Than the GDP of the United States and Japan put together.
Incredible. Incredible.
And that number, that figure has doubled since 9/11.
Wow. Okay,
And the top 50 banks in this country hold $12 trillion of that.
That's such a staggering figure. I mean, it would take care of all the debt problems. That alone could take care of all the debt problems that are hanging everything up, both in Europe and everywhere,
right? But the point is, class is power.
Okay.
And having a hold over somebody is important. The 1% is not interested in community. They're interested in exclusion.
Okay.
As Halsey of Halsey Lane, I read this in the Post a few days ago, out in the Hamptons, there's a Halsey Lane. It is the offspring of that particular dynasty. He was charged with exploiting a servant of his and making her work all hours, odd hours, under bad conditions.
Like a serf. Like a slave.
Like a serf.
Yeah, right. Or a slave.
And, you know, his response was very nonchalant. In America, nothing is free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for them.
I mean, that's the mentality.
Yeah.
And these people just feed off the rest of us.
Mm-hmm.
They're parasites at this point. Because they don't produce jobs. They don't produce quality education, health care, housing.
Mm-hmm.
This is it's a disaster, the growing social disaster in this country, which I've said this before many times.
Yeah.
And they don't have any plan to solve it. As Paul Volcker said back in 2005, there's a 75% probability of a collapse of the U.S. economy in the next 5 years, and nothing's going to be done to stop it. And he was absolutely right. Nothing was done to stop it, which shows negligence, criminal negligence.
The political class does not at this time, in terms of big clout, can clean the Green Party.
No,
it's the Democrats and the Republicans.
Democrats
have gone along with it as well as they bailed them all out in 2008 happened with and there was fraud involved with those mortgage swaps where they bundled all those mortgages and put them out in the bond market and that sort of, it was fraud.
And nobody went
nobody
to jail.
Has gone to
and
jail.
Nobody went
nobody's
to
been
jail.
Even slapped on the wrist, hardly at all.
That's right.
And it just goes, and they
They've just been, finger's been pointed at them in Congress, because Congress is part of the problem.
Congress is part of the...
Because they are dependent on campaign contributions.
They are indeed. And $1 billion campaign we're looking at?
No, we're looking at just $1 billion being spent by
Obama.
Democrat.
Yeah, exactly. By the Democrats, yeah.
Exactly.
But that's like what Mr... you're too young, maybe I'm being not facetious, to remember Evan Charlie show.
Right.
You get $1 million here and $1 million there. Finally adds up to real money, right?
Right. Well, we're talking big money. I mean,
yeah.
Junior Bush won in 2000, he spent $200 million. So here we are going to 2012, and Obama's going to spend $1 billion, five times as much.
I know.
And it's all on advertising. See, the only reason why Perot did so well is he used $100 million of his own money in 92, which is more money, obviously worth much more today than $100 million, because he got exposure.
But then is it true that he is just moving the deck chairs on the Titanic, in a sense? I mean, they're not making there's qualitative change, systemic reform and change is required in order to get to anything like a sustainable future that we can see.
No.
And neither the Democrats nor the Republicans have the ability to get out of their swoon to history, reifying and outdated institutions that have to be qualitatively changed. Reform a la revolution is decidedly in the air and should be on the agenda of the American people and the people of the world.
Well, that's what's happening.
You think it is happening with the Occupy?
Well, the Occupy. You had what happened in Wisconsin. You had what happened in Egypt. You're not going to be able to stem this.
Mm-hmm.
So the rich are just busy secretly offshoring their income, actually stealing from the IRS.
Uh-huh.
And there's no accountability.
Yeah.
And it's completely out of control. The reason is they're not creating jobs. First generation in the United States will do less well than their parents, You know, the first phase of American history, if you want to look at U.S. history as a play in three acts under capitalism, the first act, agriculture created jobs, the second act, industry created jobs, the third act, computers, takes away jobs, and also because of the technological facility that computers allow for, you can downsize and outsource.
They
outsource jobs, and they've offshored the money.
But wait a minute.
So not only were the banks not held liable and bailed out, but they're doing the same thing today.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing the same thing today. And they are serving the very people there, especially the 90,000, that have $10 trillion offshored. 90,000 people globally have $10
trillion. That's absurd. That's like 0.001% or something.
Exactly.
And what, say it again. I mean, just...
91,000...
People, individuals,
have $10 trillion offshored.
Offshored.
Right.
Are the figures, those figures are...
Conservative.
Those are conservative.
James Henry talked about...
James Henry is the head of the Tax Justice Network.
That's correct.
Yeah, there's a Tax Justice Network USA as well, doing it, looking, accountants and so forth, looking at that.
Right. He's been examining this for many years.
Yeah, but that thing you said, if we could, that thing you said, three phases and everything, the first, agriculture and then industrial... and then the computers. That's the age that we're coming into now. That's the future. And you said it takes away jobs.
Yes.
If you have an algorithm that can do what 50,000 clerks were able to do, is it, whether or not, whoever's in office, that's something that's in the zeitgeist? That the idea that you're going to be able to have the way to distribute demand or buying power to the people is through a job on an estate where all the assets are owned by a tiny class of people?
Well, it's a refutilization.
It's a refutilization,
well, right,
making
there's
feudalism.
There's the aristocracy, these trust fund babies, and people who are employed by them.
But it's if I may, if you've got something that is Keynes, who is a darling of Roosevelt, or has set up everything,
right.
Bretton Woods, everything, International Monetary, the whole order that's there, did say in a letter, I think I've said it to you before, he said in a letter to his grandchildren, you're going to be confronted with something, the grandchildren, about now, 1930, he put it out, letter to the grandchildren, you're going to be confronted with something you cannot quite understand now, he called it a disease, and you're going to be technologically induced unemployment. You have a technological capability, which in terms of ownership of assets, or ownership of natural resources, ownership of processes, intellectual property rights, translates out into, in many cases, private property, private sector productive capability to produce an overwhelming cornucopia of things.
Well, that was the Pulitzer Prize-winning book in 1954,
Which one?
David Potter's book about the U.S. called People of Plenty.
Talk about it. Talk
people
about it.
People of plenty.
Well, talk about
the point is...
Was that Robert Theobald's
No,
time?
No, there was David Potter. He was a historian.
Talk about
the fact that the United States has become a people of plenty. What he didn't understand, though, in terms of the cycles of history, the outcome of the Second World War is what allowed the United States to become a people of plenty because no country sacrificed so little and gained so much. At the height of the Second World War,
it also got us out of the Great Depression.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, seven times as much money was spent on the Second World War than spent on the New Deal. That got us out, and it created this illusion of unlimited prosperity.
Go ahead.
And in the 60s, they talked about planned ops. They talked about leisure time. But the problem is the ownership of the means of production is in the hands of a very few people. And the results of that production are not evenly distributed. Not adequately distributed, so that we could have, you know, even in the 30s, Van Arsdale was calling for reduction of the work week to 30 hours. You need to reduce the work week even further, spread the work around, and you have to go after the secret, conspiratorially sequestered assets that are being taken out of this country and offshored.
Yeah.
In Switzerland. The
Cayman Islands. There's a number of them around the world.
But also the 50 private banks. If you go to the banks, they say private client bank. You see that on Chase. They're actually advertising the fact that they can hide your assets and hide your money so that you don't have to pay. I mean, this is a crime being committed against the public, against the American people, against the people of the globe.
But back to that question of it's going to take jobs away. The labor. I was from Detroit. My granddad was a labor organizer with the lithographers, the guild. And there wasn't any turn of the century. And then there was all that CIO. All had to be built. But they came to have real clout. They used to have across the street from the White House. They had 40-50% representation within the unions. And the union represented Solidarity Forever, Woody Guthrie, all of that. They had real clout. They never did argue for ownership of the capital assets.
Well, that was a mistake.
Because they were hung up. That would be the left, let's say.
Well, let's put it this way.
They were hung up on an idea that came out of Marx, perhaps. I don't know where it came from or something, but they were hung up on reifying the labor theory of value because they were saying labor creates the wealth. Labor is what creates it. They want to hold on to that idea.
Well, Marx isn't the only one who said that. Adam Smith said it. David Ricardo said that.
Well, okay, we could address
it. The capitalist economics economist said that as well.
Well, maybe so, right. Because what every political economy in the world, national and so forth, when you think about the distribution of demand or buying power in a legitimate way to the mass of the people of the society, they assume the only way to get money to the people is for them to have a job.
Right.
Where they get money for what they do on the estate, where seemingly from the progressive side, it's perfectly all right for a tiny plutocratic class to own all the natural resources, all the capital assets, all the technology going,
and
all
the computers. And not pay any taxes.
And not pay, and they get to be so powerful.
That's
but
right.
They could have bargained when they had real power for ownership of the capital assets, and they never did.
Well, that was too much to...
They never did,
because
they were trying to get a minimum wage or maybe an improved wage
but,
or something,
but
they put the value on the labor.
In the 1920s, the membership in labor unions had been reduced to 7% of the workforce.
It was in 1920s? Yeah.
Yeah, 7%.
It got up to about 40, 50% by the time
the maximum was 1955, 35%. But...
Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. You
only 35% of the workforce at maximum was.
Okay.
It's now 11.8%, the lowest since 1935.
It's less than that in the private sector alone.
Right. It's about 6 or 7%.
That's right. That's come down a long way.
Right.
So they're bargaining away all their power. They don't have any power to assert the rights of the poor people, who only wait for them to get money is to have a job. On the estate.
And your taxes are taken out in advance, and you have to collect them the following year.
Right.
Whereas the rich can send their money abroad, have a secret bank account. Switzerland pioneered it in 1934 to shelter those investing.
That's what we're talking about.
Investing in Hitler, because Switzerland was a conduit supporting the Nazis.
Right.
As was Spain and Sweden.
Prescott Bush was, too.
And Prescott Bush was key to this.
Right.
He was... involved in secretly financing the Germans, as was Exxon and as Standard Oil in those days.
So the plutocrats who owned the capital assets got more and more, and they got ways in which they could have exert power and influence over the way the system is set up to where that's what's running things now.
But they always were in control, Harold. That's
they always the have been.
They always accepted the geographical isolation and the fact that the United States was land rich and labor poor created the illusion that somehow the workers were in active control of the society when they were not.
Well,
the plutocrats have always been in control here. They've always been in control since the founding of the first permanent settlement at Jamestown, except that the economy was so good and growing, and you had to fill out the continent.
I would think throughout all of human history, you had pharaohs, you had emperors, you had all kinds of things. You had kings for 1,000 years after Rome. Always there's a small group who runs everything, and then everybody else wallowing around in the mud.
Well, there are
like serfs.
There are exceptions to the rule.
Yeah.
But the point is, you get class society when you get agriculture, when somebody's land is better than somebody else's land, and then soon the disparity grows.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it's all about landed wealth in the up to the medieval period, and then the modern period is characterized by capitalism.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and the steam engine, and the industrial revolution.
Well, who has the money?
Yeah, and it's there now.
Not
and
who
now,
has the land?
And now we're getting to a point where this article is staggering about how much of that wealth that they would like to avoid paying the taxes, which we have a system where we can have some taking for the public sector, public commons, and that sort of thing.
They use public services, too. They
I know
use
that.
Public services.
They use the roads, don't they?
They use the roads.
Yeah. Yeah, but after the Second World War, the tax rate was up 92% under Eisenhower, right out of the Second World War.
That's right.
I mean, he wanted to make it 100% if he could.
Well,
it
was in the 90s, in the 50s. It dropped to 71% under Carter.
Uh-huh.
It went to 31% under Reagan.
Okay.
And it rose under Clinton to 35%. Or maybe 39, and now it's down to 35%.
Okay,
but don't forget, Obama helped the rich out as well. I mean, the Democrats and Obama controlled Congress and the White House from 2009 to 2008 election to 2010, the midterm elections.
Uh-huh.
And in 2010, there was no estate tax collected in this country.
Is that right? I didn't realize that. Yeah,
no estate tax whatsoever.
Yeah.
$10 billion was lost by the Treasury.
Thanks to this. That's a, like a real money again, yeah.
Exactly. And don't forget
Mr.
also...
William Buffett had an interesting take on that, I think.
He was, but also, he froze Social Security. Mm-hmm. 2009, 2010, Social Security was frozen. Mm-hmm. But the profits of the banks, the bonuses of the bankers...
Still went on.
There was no... It's what somebody said. Socialism of loss... Privatization of profit.
Right.
So it's a win-win situation. You can be a rich dummy and always win if you have assets in banks and you have offshore accounts and you can hire an accountant to do whatever. And you don't have to do anything except go from island to island and from the Monaco to Gestad to Vail. I mean, we're supporting a class of parasites who prey off the public and on the planet.
Okay. What's the solution?
The solution is I take an electoral solution, but okay. I'm under no illusion that we're going to be able to take power. We can raise the issues and try to educate the public. But in the case of Huey Long, for instance, he was very effective. He would, of course, Roosevelt the election in 1936, and so he was assassinated in 35. He's the first U.S. senator, sitting senator in U.S. history to be assassinated. Bobby Kennedy in 68 was going to come in, open up the Kennedy assassination files. He appealed to both black and white. And what the plutocrats thrive on is division. In division, there is strait. In dividum imperium est, the Roman way of rule. You divide people ethnically. Divide and conquer, precisely. Uh-huh. Religiously or ethnically. And he was winning. He won the California primary on, I guess, June 8th, 1968, and then he's assassinated. We've only had two senators in the history of this country who were assassinated, and both of them brought people together, brought the public together, and they're gone. The warlords, the warmongers, the racists like Strom Thurmond, the longest-serving U.S. senator, who they kept in power, even when they had to wheel him in from Walter Reed Hospital and pick his hand up to vote, was a racist.
Absolutely, and they really
and went after John Lennon, went after anybody who was for peace, deliberately trying to undermine people who are for peace instead of war. And the Green Party, our symbol in New York State is the peace symbol on the ballot. You'll see us on the
ballot because
we have the peace symbol.
The
Green Party in New York State symbol is not a donkey. It's not an elephant. But it's the peace symbol.
Okay, and that's the thing that's been there. There's always been this contingent among people, some people, but they've never been able to follow it and so forth, and other kinds of people of a socialist bent.
Well, because kind of historical reasons. The system had to play itself out. The geographical isolation allowed the United States in both world wars to reap the profits from war because its economy remained intact. So that's the key.
But as
a consequence of the Second World War, the United States bore the military brunt of defending the capitalist world. And they had to rebuild Germany and Japan because the best capitalists are fascists because they can really squeeze it out of people. And they had... And from their perspective, maintaining their power after the Second World War, they had to rebuild Japan and Germany. And furthermore, they had to go after China because China revised Marx. Mao revised Marx. He built his revolution on the peasantry, not on the working class. And that really freaked the 1% out in D.C.
Wait, go back to there. I'm trying to understand the China thing coming up. They got the new guy coming in China's understanding. What his and I can't quite understand it, but his area of expertise, as it were, is dialectical materialism of Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. They claim to be Marxists. They say we are the Marxist revolutionaries of the Marxist tradition, and they cling to their political power through a religious acceptance of Marxism as a reading of human history and so forth.
Well, I was talking about Mao as a revolutionary force in the 40s and 50s and 60s in China.
But I'm saying what's emerged now is it seems to me like
it's state a one-party system. Yes,
yeah,
that's
right. It's state capitalism. They won't allow Qigong except as a health thing where you can do exercise. But if you bring up, they don't want to hear anything about Confucius or Lao Tzu or anything else that would compete with their claim to power through the political acceptance of being Marxists. No. How in the hell can they pull
that
ask, off?
Ask all the companies why they invest in China, that, if that's true. Why are they investing in a Marxist, a Communist
well, no,
Party
what,
dictatorship?
It's like a, it seems like flim-flam or Wizard of Oz or well, something whatever. Like that kind of world in which we live. But I mean, because is the left dead?
Where?
I mean, when you've had a thing where they got they're claiming Marx. Is there a
thing? Well, I'm not an expert on internal affairs of China.
Not internal affairs. I'm talking about the historical development of the country. Is the socialist critique able to be one that we can repair to in order to get some
well,
sort we'll of
alternative?
Well,
we'll have to, because we have to share.
We have to.
We have to.
Why?
Why? Because there's so much poverty in the world, and poverty creates the sense that I have nothing to lose. And I will sacrifice myself because things are so bad. And because the established left parties were wiped out in places like Egypt.
Well, is the left dead? Is the left dead? Except we got a couple of things like the Green Party.
Well, no, you got Greece.
I mean,
the Greeks, the left almost took power. Almost, 0.5% away.
Okay, yeah.
They're not going to resolve this. This crisis cannot be resolved within, as the, shall I say, let me put it this way.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the slogans of a lot of the occupiers is that capitalism can't reform itself.
Okay.
Now, that was the slogan of the old left.
Okay.
What SDS introduced was participatory democracy. Why Occupy has legs is because it takes the thesis of the old left, capitalism can't reform itself, all out on May Day, general strike, and synthesizes it with the antithesis, which was participatory democracy,
well,
which
wait,
went against the old.
Participatory in what sense?
That we all making decisions. We're all making the decisions.
Okay.
That's why Occupy has no leaders.
Uh-huh.
So what they do is take the thesis, there's the antithesis, which was SDS, to create the synthesis that is Occupy. Mm-hmm. And so long as the debt is going to exist, so long as people are not being allowed to participate in the political process or run candidates, and the candidates have to have a lot of money to run, this system is going down, and it continues to go down. There is no future here under the current system
that we have. Are you talking here in the United States
yes,
or
in
here
the United
on
States.
Planet Earth?
I'm talking, well,
what's
I'm talking
going
about
to be
planet
happening?
Earth. I don't know, but it may be chaos with global warming.
Yeah, which that's another thing. That's
which
coming.
This guy Mueller, who was one of the chief global warming deniers, has come around. Mm-hmm. And is now accepting global warming.
Okay.
It should be obvious, given what's going on in the Midwest.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're going to have a full-scale crisis. That's why they're militarizing the police. They're bringing in the...
Seems that way to me, and this is being done under Obama. They're laying the groundwork for the predicate for an out-and-out police
state. So they're going to have civil wars in all these countries.
Yeah, and
civil
don't
wars.
You think they sense that?
Of course they sense it, because they have no solution.
Uh-huh.
If they couldn't even listen to Volcker, what good are they?
Well,
these
okay.
people are moral cowards who are running this system here. They have no sense of civic responsibility,
okay, let's
as
talk
Ralph
about,
Nader used to talk about.
Okay, Ralph Nader ran and had integrity. He had
that's
integrity
correct,
ran,
and he was
and
pilloried
sort of yeah.
by the 1%.
Right.
By the
right.
Salzburgers of the Times, mm-hmm. by the Zuckermans of the News,
mm-hmm.
and by the Murdochs of the Post.
Mm-hmm.
Three dynasties that run the media in New York that are more interested in the final analysis with the welfare of the 1% than the welfare of the people. You cannot continue to have a system like you have in New York City, which has greater polarities of wealth than any city in the United States
is that true?
And the world. Yes.
Is that true? Really?
Yes.
Okay,
of course.
That's good. Yeah, you do.
Fiscal Policy Institute.
Your book here,
shows
Race
this.
And Class Politics.
Well, I dealt with the period before the,
yeah.
before the Civil War. This
yeah,
is.
Yeah, I know.
But
yeah.
I teach urban politics.
I know you do.
And I am involved in it. And the Fiscal Policy Institute came out with the studies that this polarity is greater than ever before.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in the Bronx, a third of the people are on food stamps. How can you continue a system like it? It's broken down. The social fabric here is worn. Mm-hmm. And the solution of the mayor is to stop and frisk and terrorize the students I have to teach. They're afraid to take an exam because they happen to be African and Latino, because they might be thrown against the car, beaten up by the cops.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Since Bloomberg came to power,
mm-hmm.
when he came to power, 90,000 stop and frisks were occurring in the city. This year it is 700,000.
Good grief almighty.
700,000. Really?
And they're mostly all up in Harlem or something. You
well,
know?
They're yeah. all over the city.
And
if
they're filling
to be
our
African Latino.
They got a
we
prison
have the largest prison
complex.
Population in the world.
In the world, yeah.
The
yeah,
largest
yeah.
in the world.
Mm-hmm.
22% of the world's prisoners with 4% of the world's population.
Yeah.
Don't dare talk to me about human rights. We have 20,000 people under solitary confinement, which is a form of torture.
It is indeed.
We
absolutely
know this.
Horrible.
Everybody
yeah.
knows this.
Yeah.
All the psychosocial studies have been done.
Uh-huh.
How many in England?
Uh-huh. I don't know.
90.
Okay, yeah, right.
How many in Canada? 40.
Uh-huh. Right, right.
In the total population.
Uh-huh.
Solitary confinement.
Okay.
I mean, this society is returning to its roots.
Uh-huh.
Its plantation roots.
Uh-huh.
Slavery.
Feudal.
Indentured servitude,
uh-huh.
which most whites endured before uh-huh. when they came here up until 1800.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
But the plantations now are called Walmart and the Pentagon.
And these, we want to get to it because this thing about the offshore banking and everything.
We could solve every debt problem on the planet.
Yeah, lay it out.
With the money.
Yeah,
with the money.
Yeah. With the money that is hidden.
With the money that's hidden and sequestered by the elites. Not only elites here, but the elite in Nigeria.
Yeah.
Nigeria is not a debtor nation. It's
yeah.
a creditor nation
yeah.
if you count up the assets that are being hidden in these offshore accounts.
But it includes virtually the entire leadership element of the world because they're all in sync with it and they all wink-wink, nod-nod. They know these things are
of
going
course.
On. They could, there are things that could be done, but there's nobody in a position of authority to question even this, which could solve the debt thing as you're talking about.
We know what the problem is. We know what the problem is.
But
we have an excellent analysis right here of
the problem.
That
is good.
Problem.
Everyone should be aware of that.
We just don't have
what?
The political will or organization.
Uh-huh.
Now, are we going to do this peacefully or are we going to do this violently?
Uh-huh.
Are we going to do this peacefully or are we going to do it violently? Because if you don't solve these problems, these social problems peacefully, and stopping and frisking every African Latino youth that you see on the street
mm-hmm.
is not the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
There's great hostility to the police because of this
yeah.
under Bloomberg.
Yeah, 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 I know, yeah. And they broke
who,
up.
Who, by the way, ignored the will of the people in taking a third term.
Mm.
So he could enhance his fortune. On paper, I don't know how much he has in offshore accounts,
mm-hmm.
went from $4 billion in 2000 to $22 billion today. He's the richest mayor in history.
Yeah, right.
And he's living off the people.
Uh-huh. And the facts of this thing about the tax havens and everything are well documented.
They're very well
documented. These are secret accounts. How do they get to know so much about the secret accounts and
well,
the fact
that
these
things... Well, he has a 49-page position paper, which
yeah.
I read.
Mm-hmm.
Which is within the article here.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they have one. The article is highly and it's an organization, Tax Justice Network,
right, but you,
has a lot of people,
yeah.
and it's a research thing. It lays a lot of this out, the research is done, that makes this clear that this is the case.
Right.
It's not as though it's just some sort of thing that's thrown up, you know.
No, they've been doing this and now nobody disputes this. The question is getting the message out.
Mm-hmm.
Like the Green Party is a viable social and political alternative, but it just can't get coverage
uh-huh.
because of the way the media is constructed.
Because of the media.
Because of the media, the corporate media.
We're part of the media here.
Yeah, but you're...
We're just one of the people.
Yes, exactly.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Manhattan Neighborhood Network does not have the clout that NBC or ABC
I,
has,
I think
which are owned by corporations.
I know, they're all owned by the corporate, and they're all in on it. It's weak, weak, not, not. And the court system... And the judicial system and the whole thing, it's like an enchant regime.
No, law has nothing to do with justice.
Okay.
It's an expression of power relationships within society.
Okay, thank
you.
The
more that can be dressed up as justice to fool the people, the more they can get away with it.
Uh-huh.
That's all.
Uh-huh. So, and this tax justice thing is really important. It could be done. And this article seems to me is one that it sure got my attention and so forth because it is so endemic and it's just part of doing business, apparently, and they're hiding the money in the Cayman Islands and so forth, and they can get away with it.
The Cayman
it.
Islands Where is a British entity.
Yeah.
It's not just
is
something...
Is it really?
Off.
I
yes,
didn't realize.
Yeah, you can look it up on Wikipedia.
Yeah, right, okay.
It still is.
Yeah. And this began in the 30s, this thing or so. Or
well,
so.
Actually, it began with the Caymans in the
1700s. 1700s? That
yes.
far back?
Yeah.
Wow, okay. The hiding of money by the ones who were accumulating wealth.
Well,
and so
they
forth,
were using
to
it
avoid
as a,
tax, and that's to avoid taxes.
Sure.
And the main thing
but
was
it became
the public
big time,
sector.
It became, you know, Switzerland pioneered in the modern era.
Mm-hmm.
With its secret bank accounts.
Right, numbered accounts, yeah.
Numbered accounts. In 1934,
yeah.
To, you know, secretly finance Hitler.
Yeah.
Because it's no accident Hitler comes to power in 33, mm. and the Swiss bank accounts go secret in 34. But
uh-huh.
really, in the new millennium, it is multiplied mm-hmm. tremendously.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time that they're crying that they have no money for public services, mm-hmm. which the rich also
and
use.
And what taxes they'll get from the low, the middle and lower
they'll
classes.
Just drive,
they'll just drive that.
So finally,
yeah.
there was going to be a spark that would create a flame that would sweep through the country, through the world, and that's the Occupy movement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I lived long enough to see it trying to be born.
Right.
And I've got great hope that it will be able to bring...
Well, obviously it's going to continue because there's no solution to the debt problem other than utilizing assets that have been illegally, secretly salted away,
yeah.
stolen from
yeah,
the public.
Right. Yeah, right, right.
And these people don't work. You can go up to there's a nightclub on 81st Street across from Frankie Campbell's.
I don't know.
I was there. Well, this is,
yeah.
I forget the name of it.
Yeah.
Right across the street, and you can see the rich coming in there, and you know they don't do anything. All they do is party. Or you can go to Nello's on 62nd and Madison, where you can see them sitting,
mm-hmm.
where some social register babes
uh-huh.
entertain the cops who killed one of the either Anthony Boz or no, it was Diallo.
Mm-hmm.
I can't keep the murders of the police straight in
Amadou
this city.
Diallo. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And they were entertaining. I wish I had kept the Post cover, which had them being entertained. These guys who murdered this guy at his wedding party.
What's to be done in a historical context? We've come up. If you see it in large context, back to Lord Keynes saying there's going to be displacement of labor in the productive process.
That's why he wanted one currency. He wanted a currency.
Who?
Keynes did. He wanted a universal currency after the Second World War called the Bancor.
Mm-hmm.
But the U.S. said, no, we want to make it the dollar.
Mm-hmm.
So Keynes said, you do that, ultimately, most of the world will become pauperized as a consequence of that. I don't think we have time to go into the economic analysis. But the point is, Keynesian economics only worked when there was no national debt.
Mm-hmm.
And we had no national debt in the 1930s because we had no military.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as we get a military, we get a debt.
Yeah.
96% of the bases, foreign bases, military mm-hmm. bases in the world are owned by the United States.
Yeah, I know
it's
that.
Just like Rome.
Yeah,
and
right.
we're fighting on the frontier. And what's
right.
the frontier? It's like the Romans did. The Romans were fighting the German tribes. The Americans are in Afghanistan. This is
right.
the longest war in history.
Uh-huh.
It's a tremendous strain. Stiglitz.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Krugman.
Yeah.
Stiglitz wrote a book.
Oh,
$3 trillion debt.
Yeah.
$3 trillion cost the Iraq War.
I know. We have... Amy had a piece about this. We wanted to just about get it in.
Yeah.
Okay, Amy did
I
a
saw
piece
you on
in,
the picnic on Saturday, and Amy had the piece on
yeah,
Monday.
Yeah, let's see if we can... We just about got time to get that in. We can just about fit it in. I'm sorry I got carried away. Amy had this and addressed it. So could we run that piece? It runs about 10 minutes. And so that'll just about take us out. But could you run that piece now? It occurred to me, if you could set that up, Nolan, run that piece with Amy Goodman talking with the director or the person who put this report together that's so important. So if you could set that up and run that, because she's in on the crowd, as it were, that's trying to make a major change and would relate
to
Occupy.
Well, she interviewed Henry, James Henry, who's the author of the
Yeah. Okay, here we go.
Piece.
Let's run this now then.
DOJ is for the love of money. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we turn now to a new report that reveals how wealthy individuals and their families have between $21 and $32 trillion of hidden financial assets around the world in what are known as offshore accounts or tax havens. The conservative estimate of $21 trillion, conservative estimate, is as much money as the entire annual economic output of the United States and Japan combined. The actual sums could be higher because the study only deals with financial wealth deposited in bank and investment accounts and not other assets such as property and yachts. The inquiry was commissioned by the Tax Justice Network and is being touted as the most comprehensive report ever on the offshore economy. It's called The Price of Offshore Revisited. The study finds private banks are deeply involved in running offshore havens, with UBS, Credit Suisse, Goldman Sachs handling the most assets offshore. According to the report, less than 100,000 people worldwide own almost $10 trillion of the wealth held in tax havens. To talk about the implications of these findings, we're joined by the report's author, James Henry, economist, lawyer, board member of the Tax Justice Network, former chief economist at McKinsey & Company. Welcome to Democracy Now!
Thanks very much.
It's great to have you with us. Tell us what you found.
Well, the $21 trillion figure is a headline story. That's a shock to a lot of people. Actually, it represents about 10% to 15% of global wealth. So from that standpoint, we think it's a reasonable number. But the interesting thing is that all of this wealth accrues to the top 10 million people on the planet, and a lot of it just to the top 100,000 people with assets over 30 million per household. The second thing that's striking about this is the role of the great international banks that we've all come to know and love, the ones you described, UBS, Credit Suisse, HSBC, JP Morgan, all these banks, Goldman, big recipients of bailout money from taxpayers, and also deeply implicated in the financial crisis of 2008 to the current period. These are the same folks that have specialized in helping the wealthiest people on the planet take their money offshore and hide it from tax authorities.
You talk about pirate banks.
Right.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, this is the business of taking money and moving it to secret offshore accounts and sheltering it from taxes. For example, if you are a wealthy Mexican investor, you can hold your bank deposits in New York City and Citibank or UBS tax-free. The U.S. government doesn't collect taxes on bank deposits by non-resident aliens. And it doesn't tell the Mexican authorities that you're earning all that money. So basically, we have designed our tax laws, the United States, the UK, Switzerland, to become the largest tax havens in the world. The actual offshore islands, like the Caymans, are just conduits to these ultimate destinations.
People would say, well, we knew that about Swiss banks, but that's not the same for U.S. banks.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. The leaders in the pack here historically have been U.K. banks, U.S. banks, and Swiss banks. And so, you know, we are all upset. Our Treasury is trying to get the Swiss private bankers to stop coming to the United States and taking money from wealthy Americans. But our banks have been doing the same thing for decades with respect to Latin America, the Philippines, you know, much of Africa. And that's a system that the banks have really designed.
Let's talk about the continent of Africa and what this means for various countries and, most importantly, the majority of the populations there.
Yeah. Well, for example, Nigeria is supposedly a debtor country, but when you look at all the unrecorded capital outflows that have flowed out of Nigeria, it turns out that Nigeria is actually, like many other developing countries, a net creditor of the richest countries in the world. So that if you add up and accumulate all the unrecorded capital flows that have accrued to the Nigerian elite, political as well as private sector, you know, that the tiny share of that country's population owns a vast amount of offshore wealth. So the debt problem is not really a debt problem, it's a tax problem. Developing countries account for about a third, we estimate, of the 21 to 32 trillion of financial assets that's offshore.
Some of the critiques of the report, the investigation you did, this is from CNBC. Quote, the problem, says Dan Mitchell, a senior fellow at the Cato Institute, is that the estimate is based on a series of assumptions aimed at making people believe that much of cross-border investing is all about tax evasion and that all this money should go to government and that this would be a good thing. That's what he says. The real problem facing governments, Mitchell says, is spending, not revenues. Your response, James?
Well, my response is that he hasn't read the report, basically. We've been been very careful to estimate the size of this black hole using three different methods. We've looked individually at the top 50 banks in the world and have detailed numbers for each one of them. We've looked at 139 developing countries where we can get data on how much their unrecorded capital flows were, and we built detailed models of those. And we looked at data published by the Bank for International Settlements. So the numbers are the best ever recorded here. We're not suggesting that there may not be problems on the spending side, but it's outrageous for the wealthiest people on the planet to pay zero taxes. And what this does to developing countries in particular, because they can't tax income, because they can't tax wealth, they end up taxing low and middle income people with VAT taxes and sales taxes that are regressive. So basically what you're seeing is the globalization is driving a big hole through the nation state system that was designed to raise tax revenue.
Let's go to Mitt Romney, because that's why the whole issue of offshore accounts has come into the big consciousness of the overall American population right now. The presumptive Republican presidential nominee speaking to Radio Iowa earlier this month about his foreign investments.
With regards to any foreign investments, I understand, and you understand, of course, that my investments have been held by a blind trust, have been managed by a trustee. I don't manage them. Don't even know where they are. That trustee follows all U.S. laws. All the taxes are paid as appropriate. All of them have been reported to the government. There's nothing hidden there. There's nothing. If for instance, you own shares in, let's say, Renault or in Fiat, you still have to pay taxes. You still have to disclose that in the United States.
That's Mitt Romney, James Henry.
Yeah. Well, he's not alone. That's one estimate, one indication of our report. You know, basically, you're looking at behavior that's engaged in by a lot of Mitt Romneys, and you know, essentially, the United States is facing kind of a stark choice in election, in this election, between the first president in history who, you know, has really had offshore accounts like this. You know, a lot of us who are tax experts and not necessarily Democrats by any means just wonder what the heck is he hiding there. There must be something. You know, John McCain released 23 years of his tax reports, tax returns. Romney is still stopping with 2010. So if there's no problem, just release the returns.
I want to go more to Mitt Romney's the issue of his hidden wealth. He was speaking to Face the Nation. Senator Dick Durbin of Illinois challenged Mitt Romney's to be more transparent with his finances.
Mitt Romney has failed to make an economic disclosure that every president and candidate for president has made in the last 36 years. Goes back to his father, who disclosed 12 years of tax returns. He's disclosed one. Secondly, he is the first and only candidate for president of the United States with a Swiss bank account, with tax shelters, with tax avoidance schemes that involve so many foreign countries. And the third is that when it comes down to his Swiss bank account, there is just no way to explain it. Okay. You either get a Swiss bank account to conceal what you're doing, or you believe the Swiss franc is stronger than the American dollar.
That's Senator Durbin, James Henry.
Well, I think that he's absolutely right. We should demand a disclosure. This is a situation.
Okay, really, really, that's really something went on with a couple of minutes you had to cut off. It's really heavy duty. I'm glad Amy's picked up on it, that you picked up on, Green Party's picked up on, and others. And this will be part of a thing that could begin to be, penetrate the national consciousness and so forth, because it's absurd and it's got to be addressed in a way.
The money's there.
Do you think it'll come up? Will it be able to come up in a way that just would hidden. Be relevant to, let's say, the presidential election or to real change that can be made? That might be able to make things move along in a more appropriate way. We only got a couple of minutes or so left.
I mean,
what is your thought? Can they get their act in order, into the leadership of the world, in order to address this crisis that we're coming into or not? We only got about a minute left. So.
I think I would agree with Paul Volcker. They're not going to do anything about it until they lose control.
And until they lose control. By that you mean the leadership element that so far They haven't got an operating manual for spaceship Earth that's required for the future in terms of what has to be got.
Absolutely.
Where is that going to come from if it comes from anywhere?
It's going to come from the 99%.
From the 99% and from the Occupy,
Absolutely.
Green Party. Green
but
Party.
I'm talking about the people all over the planet,
right.
The Occupies and the people's movements, mass movements occurring.
That might
everywhere.
Come out of things that seem like long shots, like the Green Party and public access television and the people that are thought as being of no real significance by those who are so comfortably ensconced in the outdated order, which we need a new qualitative transformation for. Tony, thank you for
again,
all the
Harold.
Good work. Back
thank
to the
you,
60s,
Harold.
Carrying on the work. Thanks
well,
a lot.
We've got to pick up where the 60s left off
right.
with Malcolm and Martin.
Well, maybe that, or maybe to the 70s, anywhere there was real qualitative existential change going on. Your pleasure, Tony Gronowicz. He's running for the 14th Congressional District, New York. Best of luck in the election.
Thanks again, Harold.
Give my best to all the gang at the Green Party. And
I shall.
Try to get them over here to let's participate
oh,
and grow.
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you for viewing. We'll be coming back again tomorrow. That's it for now. Once again, Tony, thanks for all the good work, such a well-led life, and particularly for calling my attention to this really crucial issue of offshore banking. It's amazing. Thank you for viewing. We're coming back tomorrow. Thank you.